Assalamu alaikum, brothers and sisters, and welcome to another episode of Brother to Brother. Now, in our last episode, we had Brother Aus Asfar come into our studios and share with us his insight on sister and brother relations. Now, we'd like to delve into the show right away and get going. Now, Brother Aus, I just want to touch upon first parents that give too much control and power to a certain sibling. Now, first talk to us a little bit about the rights of an older brother.
Well, I mean, the rights of an older brother or the rights of an older sister would probably be appropriate. Because you find, for example, if you have a sister that's older, what she tends to do is she feels that she needs to be nurturing, she needs to be the one, and she's the one that's always teaching. Remember what I mentioned about my daughter, how she's taken on that role of nurturing my son Ali and trying to take care of him and teaching him how to read and all of this business, okay? Helping her mom change him. So you find from a very young age, especially girls, they're a lot more nurturing. So when they grow up and they are kind of blasted with the reality that, well, he's the older son, and she's no longer the oldest sort of thing, and the son is the one, you know, that carries the family name, you find that there's a deficiency that's felt by the sister, and this doesn't always happen, of course, you know. I mean, but most of the time, this is common. This is what you find in the psychology books, and this is if you just observe it and analyze people's behavior, this is what you'll notice. Okay, so if we talk about the sister first, now the sister, obviously, in terms of what rights she has over her brothers as an authority figure, is absolutely none by Shara, by Islamic law, by divine legislation. However, of course, we look at Fatima al-Zahra, salamullahi alayha, you know, and she was known as Ummu Abiha, you know, and she took care of her father, you see? I mean, and that's a huge, much bigger role. So now, if we really want to analyze the fact that the role that the sister actually has, practically speaking, okay, is that she must understand what her role is and not try to take on a bigger role than is rightfully hers. And the same goes for the brother, right? The brother, yes, if you look at, for example, the Code of Practice for Muslims in the West for Sayyid Sistani, a wonderful book if anybody has a chance to pick it up. It has a section that's about social relations. And in there, Samahat Ayatollah Sayyid Sistani, Adamallah Dhullah, he says in there that the older brother has the rights onto his younger siblings that the father has. Now, does that mean that the older brother has the right to say yay or nay for his sister to get married? No. Okay. But in terms of respect, yes. Okay. The guardians, the legal guardians of the children, are the father or the grandfather or the paternal grandfather. Okay. So if this young man comes and all of a sudden he believes, you know, no, I'm the man of the house and this is how things are done, there's a reason why he feels that way. Probably because his father taught him that, you know, or maybe even his mother taught him that. And that's where we have to be careful.
Having said that, where should the lines be drawn for excess power or control of a certain sibling?
Well, you have to start early. And we mentioned, you know, in the last episode, when I was mentioning to you how, you know, I was describing how I was setting the stage for that relationship between Zainab and Ali, you know, and you're setting the stage early on by teaching them how to respect each other, you know. When Zainab, for example, comes to me and says, you know, I don't want him to do that, okay, he shouldn't be doing that, I'll tell her, well, why don't you want him to be doing that? And is there a better way for you to explain to him that you don't want him to do this, that, or the other, you know? You can't teach the child to dictate things. If you teach them from an early age, and then they will do it when they grow older. And remember, we said you have to lead by example. Okay, so if you raise your voice at your wife or you raise your voice at your kids, you better believe that that's the only way your child will know how to react to any sort of thing that they conceive to be negative, okay? That will be their response. So where do you draw the line? You draw the line, first of all, early, okay? And if you haven't drawn the line early, then when do you draw the line? And that's right away. But how do you do it? Not, you know, wring them by the necks and drag them to their rooms and throw them in there and tell them you're never coming out, you're grounded forever, because that's really not going to work, because they're just going to rebel. And they're going to say to you, especially when they're in their teenage years, they're going to say to you, well, you never did this with us before, and you treat mom like this, and you know, you treat your own sister like this, so why do you expect me to do something that you don't do? You know, I remember watching an episode not too long ago, where you were interviewing, and it wasn't you, it was another show, where somebody was interviewing a Hajj who had just come back from Hajj, and he said, I'm pleading with my daughter to pray. I'm pleading with her. I'm telling her it's going to be good for you if you pray. Okay? And it really hurt him. And what hurt him most is he said, I couldn't give this to my child early on because I didn't realize the value of it then. But I realize the value of it now. And this is where you have to realize the value of it. You have to realize the value of it now and make the change right away and make the change gradual. Tell them, sit with them, you know, have like almost like a round table every day when you're at home, just for a half hour, 15 minutes to half hour, before you turn on that tube, that TV, and you watch television, and say, you know, tell me how your day went, okay? And what sort of things did you have problems with? Tell me what you're thinking, you know? And tell them, when you do something wrong, you know, tell them, you know, I was thinking, you might have seen me talk to your mother this way, what I did was wrong. Okay, and I apologized. Make sure you say that, and I apologized. And I'm working on myself to make those changes. Okay, and I want you to know that we are always in this constant state of change. Okay, we're not, you know, you always hear هذا طبعا. That's in Arabic, of course. In English, he's set in his ways. No, that's what makes us different as human beings. We have an intellect. And that intellect allows us to always be in a constant state of change, of improvement. And that's why Allah brought down this religion, so that we perfect ourselves. And specifically our akhlaq. Rasulullah, as you've mentioned in previous episodes, says that he came to perfect our manners. So if we perfect our manners first amongst each other and we lead by example, then the line will be drawn whether you like it or not. And it's never too late to start. Start right away, okay? And show them that you're starting with yourself. Because, as you know, if somebody is smoking, and you go up to somebody, a teenager, and you say to them, you really shouldn't be smoking, he's not going to take you seriously if you're a smoker. If it was good enough for you, it's good enough for me, right? So that's something we should always consider.
Very good information. Now, you mentioned starting early. Now, let's say that the parents have not done this. And their child, or teenager now, has control and power. And they've kind of handed this to him. And there's actually verbal abuse involved. Now, how bad is that?
It's terrible. Unfortunately, we see a lot of that in families, in our society, in society in general, not just in our own community. And because of the role and because of the double standard that tends to happen, it's a cultural double standard, it really is. You find that it does start with emotional abuse that starts off verbal. Some of it might not even be verbal, believe it or not. Sometimes just a bad look can cause that emotional abuse. And really dealing with each other in a way that is respectful, that shows good manners, is, as I mentioned before, the best way around this issue escalating. Now, okay, it's escalated. You've given your son that power. He's suspicious of his sister all the time, wherever she goes. He can go wherever he wants, you know, but she can't step out of the house, you know. Well, why is he so suspicious of her? That's what the parents should ask themselves. What is this young man doing? Or what did he do? Or what has he done that has made him so suspicious of the world?
So what does he know almost?
What does he know that we don't know, you know? And that's a true sign right there that this young man, you have to sit with, you have to understand what he's seen. And believe me, if he's a teenager, he might walk out the first couple of times, but at the end he'll break down and tell you, because no matter what, you're his father or you're his mother, and he wants to say what's going on and what he's seen, you know. And I guarantee you, 9 times out of 10, he's going to say, it's your fault because you let me be exposed to that. Because you gave him the reins early on. You didn't put your foot down. And when we say put your foot down, we're not saying be a dictator. No, when we say put your foot down from the beginning, we're saying make them know that you are the father. You're not just, you know, somebody who's hanging out and letting them stay out as long as they want. There's a saying that says, من أمن العقوبة أساء الأدب. Okay, a person who knows that he won't be punished, okay, will end up having bad manners and will do whatever they want. Okay, and that's why, even if your teenager is 18 or 19, you need to know where they're going, who they're going with. You need to control what time they're going out, you know, and that's the only way you'll know who they're being exposed to. And that's the only way you can analyze their behavior and say, well, why is this child acting this way towards their sister? Why do they think that this is okay? And if it's me, I have to start with myself, because إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَغَيْرُ مَا بِقَوْمٍ حَتَّى يَغَيْرُ مَا بِأَنفُسِهِمْ. You have to start with yourself so that Allah then will change the people around you. Okay, so, and that point really is very important, because if I'm not working on myself and I expect others to change, it's just like that guy that we mentioned a second ago who's telling the other person, you know, don't smoke, while he's, you know, smoking in front of him and blowing smoke in his face. It's just not going to work, okay? And there is no quick, easy solution. That's what everybody has to understand. And if you call a sheikh, he's not going to be able to solve it for you right away. He's going to give you practical solutions. If you take your child to a psychiatrist, okay? Psychiatrists, by the way, and psychologists, they're not made to give you answers. They're made to have you talk so that you give the answers. Okay? You give the answers, because the answers are within you.
Now, verbal abuse, you've obviously talked about in great detail here. How do we solve this issue?
Well, it can't be acceptable. And the child needs to know that it's not acceptable. Okay? So if he's looking at and I've heard of really terrible things where a brother will actually call his own sister, you know, a name that, you know, you probably wouldn't hear anybody, say to an animal. I mean, it's terrible, okay? And we see, and it's part of the normal vocabulary because of mainstream culture, because of television, because of movies, because it's normal, because it's cool, okay? And it's unacceptable. And as a parent, you have to let them know that this is unacceptable. You cannot speak to me. You cannot speak to your sister. You cannot speak to anybody else like this. This is, if it's not acceptable for you to speak to somebody else like this, it certainly is not acceptable for your sister. Okay? And if subhanAllah, you know, usually you find guys like that. It's almost like they almost have a hatred. You know, and that hatred comes from where? Because they've seen somebody hate women, and so they treat women hatefully. They've seen things or done things that make them now suspicious, because they figure everybody is like them. Don't get me wrong. It's okay to be cautious. It's okay to be careful. It's important. Okay? But, and even Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says to him, وَإِذَا كُنْتَ فَضًّا غَلِيظَ الْقَلْبِ لَمْ فَضُّوا مِنْ حَوْلِكَ. That if you are cruel to them and harsh with them, then they'll just leave your side. And that's just not the solution. And you have to tell them, whether it's through the Qur'an or whether it's telling them, you know, that لا إكراه في الدين, okay? Or it's through leading by example. And remember, Imam Sadiq says, كُنُوا دُعَاتًا لَنَا بِغَيْرِ أَلْسِنَتِكُمْ. If this child has gotten to a point of verbal abuse, sit them down, you know. Hold their face in your hands. This is your child. And say to them, this is unacceptable. Okay, this is unacceptable. We have to start by doing dua to make sure, and do dua. This is really going to help you, because you can't do this by yourself. You're going to need Allah. You're going to need your wife to buy into this. You know, you're going to need everybody around you. And if you don't have anybody around you to buy into this, then you have to stay strong and you have to stay firm. Okay, and you have to really take charge and say, no, I will not accept this from you. You have to change. You must change. And now give him a solution. Every time you mention, of course, if they're younger, say that every time you say something about your sister that is wrong, it is a lie. lying is haram. Okay, every time a lie is said, it travels up to the sky and it stinks up the angels. The angels hold, you know, so to speak, their noses and say, what a stench. Okay, it is, if they're younger, they'll get it. Okay, I've used this with my daughter. If for example, that doesn't work and they're a little older, okay, tell them, you know, other than it being from the kaba'ir, lying, slander, this is a form of slander. Okay, this is haram. Okay, all right, the haram part doesn't work. Then you say to them, how would you like it if your sister responded to you and said so and so? If she responds to me, I'll pound her head. What gives you the right? Why is it okay for you to pound your sister's head? Okay, but it's not okay for you to pound a stranger's head. Okay, because you will go to jail, because there's law. Well, you know what? That's not good enough. What you're saying, I do not accept. Those actions are unacceptable. Okay, if you're planning to act like this, okay, then you have to realize that there's something greater that's controlling you. It's not yourself anymore. Your anger is controlling you. Maybe your desire controlled you at one time. Maybe you're imagining stuff. All of these are sure signs that three powers are completely out of whack and that the intellect is not working. And now try to explain to them, you can't move forward and accuse people based on your own imagination. You probably think this is happening with your sister. You probably think this might happen. There's nothing for certain here, okay? Life is not built on just then, on just doubts and probabilities and illusions and imagination, okay? No, you have to go back and you have to look deep into yourself and say, how do I get rid of this waswas? Because that's what it is. It's a waswas. Somebody, this satanic whisper is saying to you, do this, do this, do that. Be this way with your sister, be that way with your brother, and give them a practical solution of reading قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ النَّاسِ قُلْ أَعُوذُ بِرَبِّ الْفَلَقِ. Okay? Tell them to make dua. Every time this happens, check yourself. Do muraqabah during the day. You know? And at night, do muhasabah. Muraqabah during the day is watch yourself. Be mindful of what you do. Okay? Willingly be patient when you see somebody act negatively towards you. Willingly be patient. Be of those who remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Al-Asr, والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر. Allah swears by time that man is in a constant state of loss. إلا الذين آمنوا. Except those that are of faith. وعملوا الصالحات and do well. وتواصوا بالحق and willingly hold on to the truth. وتواصوا بالصبر and willingly hold on to the time that it's important for them to be patient. Patience can be used in all facets of life, and this is one of them. And you have to keep training them. Even if you do almost like a 12-step program where you call them constantly, you say, okay, son, how are things going? Make sure that they're doing their salah. Inna salata tanha an al-fahsha wal-munkar. Salah prevents you from all of these ill doings. Okay? It creates that immunity that you have. It also helps you check yourself. And also, it makes, you know, you always hear youth say, keep it real, keep it real. This is about keeping it real. Salah is about keeping it real, you know.
What if the power and control of an older sibling, be it brother or sister, leads now to physical abuse?
Well, if it's things have escalated this far, then let's just say it's not beyond repair. It's the same process. Take a step back, analyze the situation, do a little bit of dua, let Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put some blessings in what you're trying to do, even if you were the cause before. You know, I know this friend of mine who at a very young age, believe it or not, he was, you know, back in the Middle East, it's actually normal to maybe beat your child, okay? So if a child is growing up, it's part of that discipline. So if a child is growing up and he's being smacked around every time he does something wrong, okay, then that's the only manifestation of anger that he understands. You know, he understands that in order for people to listen to me, I have to hit them. So I'm reminded by this young man who, at a very young age, you know, as I mentioned, in the Middle East, it's normal, it's a normal part of discipline to smack your child every time they do something wrong. So this young man growing up, he really didn't know any other manifestation of anger other than to be almost like a raging bull, you know, and that it's almost manly. In order for you to be a man, you have to get angry to the point that nobody can hold you back, you know, and you have to raise your hand and smack somebody. And I, you know, really looking at this young man's story, he said to me, he said, you know, when I was younger, every time something would go wrong in the house, I'd get smacked. It didn't matter if it was my fault or not, you know, to the point where my skin became like a donkey skin, okay? But I'll tell you how I did take it out. I took it out on my younger brother. Now, others might take it out on their own sisters. This is a problem, because I know, you know, we're addressing the issue of sisterhood also. And this is a complete no-no, you know. I mean, one thing that this young man said to me, he said, well, I was lucky enough to grow up knowing that you never raise your hand on a girl. So that's good, at least, you know. But even if this person is raising his hand on his sister, it's the same story. It's a story that tells you that you can control yourself if you pay attention to yourself, to your actions, and you observe yourself. He says, this one time, after my father had gotten, you know, smacking me, he goes, I took it out on my younger brother. He said, I was 11 years old, okay? And my brother was, I think he was 6 or something. It was very young. He said, all of a sudden, when I raised my hand, it's almost like time froze. And I had an out-of-body experience. And it's almost like, you know how in The Matrix, you know, you know, everybody slows down and you can see reality in a different way. Reference to that movie, of course. You know, but he managed to have this almost like an out-of-body experience where he saw himself raising his hand in slow motion and his hand coming down to beat his brother. And he said, at that point, before my hand reached the face of my brother, what happened to him? He said, I stopped. And I realized this is the action of the shaitan. This is not me. He said, I am not my father. And he stopped. He said, after that day, I stopped hitting my brother.
Now, Haj Aus, this is somebody at 11 years old who's had this realization. What about somebody who doesn't wake up and doesn't realize what they're doing?
Well, I mean, for somebody like that who doesn't wake up and is not capable of waking up at all, then he's completely recruited by Satan. No solution there. No, I'll get to him in a minute. I just want to show the stages here that this young man went through. He said, after I realized that, he goes, I still had problems with my anger. He said, I didn't manifest them physically anymore because I knew I didn't want to be like my father, which is quite sad because usually people grow up to want to be like their parents. And this is where we have, as parents, have to be careful, you know, because I want my child to look at me as a prophet, as somebody who's as close to perfect as possible. I'm not doing it for him. I'm doing it for my own self, remember? You start with yourself first, okay? But imagine if that father knew that this is how his son looked at him. Terrible thing. Maybe he would have instituted some changes if they had that conversation. Remember I said, sit them down, talk to them, let them speak. I remember one of the episodes prior when you were talking about how to be with your brother, you said, you know, zip this and just use these, you know, and listen. And that's sometimes what you have to do as a parent. Actually, you have to do that all the time. Otherwise, you're going to miss a lot of stuff. So what does he say to me? He says, the way I fixed my verbal abuse, he said, I couldn't do it by myself. He said, we were going through some rough times, and my uncle's wife, we had a situation where with one of my cousins, she said something to him, and I responded to her verbally. And my uncle came to me and he said to me, you know, I didn't expect you to respond like this to my wife. It's completely unacceptable. He said, at that point, I started thinking to myself, you know, what, you know, I didn't do anything wrong. And you know how people start to justify and Satan allows you to justify your wrongdoings. He said, at that point, my youngest uncle came to me and he said to me, he said, anytime, he said, I want you to learn this as a rule of thumb and take this as advice because, you know, I'm a person who went through this and was able to work on myself, and I'm still working on myself, he said to him. He said, anybody who raises their hand first, raises their voice first, gets out of their seat first, okay, that person will automatically be the person that is in error.
Very good advice. Very good advice.
So teach your kids that early on. Now, there is a hadith. عن رسول الله صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم that says, if you're angry, part of the hadith, I'll only give you part of the hadith. If you're angry and you're standing up, sit down. If you're sitting down, stand up. Okay? Now this doesn't contradict what this young man's uncle was saying. It's just that what he's saying is that if somebody is over your head and he's standing and that sort of thing, don't get up suddenly so that they think that, you know, you're going to attack them or something. Okay? In the case of the hadith of the Prophet, he's telling you, no, you know, not stand up abruptly, you know, but get out of the situation is what he's telling you. And what he says in the rest of the hadith is, he says that the person who is of kin to you, meaning a family member, if he is angered, then your touch, subhanAllah, just a touch from you, touching him or touching her, of course if they're mahram, touch them. If they're not mahram, you can't touch them. Okay, but touching them will ease he who is of kin. So this is great advice from Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Also, there's another hadith that says, "الغضب يأكل في إيمان المؤمن كما يأكل الخل في العسل." That that anger eats away at the faith of somebody who is of faith, just as if you were to pour vinegar into honey, it would completely, you know, eat away the honey. So we have to be careful. Okay. There's also another hadith that says that anger is like two wolves, you know, that are hungry and rabid, okay, and they're surrounding a flock of sheep, and that flock of sheep is a symbol of a person's faith, you know, and anger is just eating away at that faith. So what's the secret then from hearing these ahadith? That you have to work on your faith, okay? You have to work on your knowledge. Understand that you have to watch yourself and learn from what this young man is, this young man's journey at age, I think he said from age 11 to about 15. He said, after that day, I never got angry after that. And I never raised my hand and I never raised my voice, you know. But he said, I was only able to maintain it with time. And that maintenance, he said, he accomplished through that muraqabah, through watching himself during the day. And through that muhasabah at night, you know, really being that harsh on himself and judging himself and saying, what did I do? Did I do the right thing? Did I do the wrong thing? If I did the wrong thing, did I fix it? You know. And you have to get your children used to doing that, okay? And now we move on to that, the question, which was,
what if the violence and physical abuse gets to a point where it's beyond repair?
Well, it's interesting that you describe it as beyond repair. In some situations, it can be beyond repair, but remember, because we're human, because we have this intellect, it's never really beyond repair. There has to be a solution, okay? The solution is either going to be a solution where, you know, you find the sister will call the cops, or the sister will, and there are situations out there, you know, where the sister will respond to the brother, you know, beating her in a physical manner that will take people to jail. Alhamdulillah, I haven't heard of any stories in our community with that stuff, but I wouldn't be surprised if that does happen. Now, I've heard of stuff, for example, where, and I remember when I was up in Toronto, some of the communities that are very tightly knit and culturally bound, you know, where there might, it might escalate to a point where there's, you know, a loss of life sometimes, you know, because the sister might have done something. She might have gone against her culture and against her religion, you know, and she might have married outside of the tribe. You know, and the real question is that you have to ask yourself is when is tribe more important than religion? Because religion teaches you, okay, religion teaches you that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. He forgives, okay? So I myself as a human, I can't forgive. How can that be? Because of my tribe? Because, okay, I understand. I know there is a whole honor issue. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a system for that honor, where the retribution is through legislation, Islamic legislation and law. Okay. Know for a fact that if it's beyond repair, like you described, this young man needs to be isolated. He needs to know that, again, it's unacceptable. he cannot come close to his sister if he is planning to, he needs to talk to his sister through you. Or she needs to talk to her brother through you. And make sure that you're there when they're talking to each other. You're not always going to be there, but it means that you have to increase the time that you spend with your family. Because if you're not, okay, then this broken family is going to be broken beyond repair, just like you have that problem with that physical abuse beyond repair. You have to sit down and spend the time. You have to really, if you can't solve the situation yourself, go to a sheikh. Okay, you need to go to a psychologist. There's nothing wrong with that. Go to a psychologist. Okay, but seek the Islamic solutions, because those Islamic solutions work straight at the core of that spirit. Okay, and repairing that spirit. Okay, and once you talk to the sheikh will probably advise you and say, well, why don't you have your son, you know, come to our youth program? You know, why don't you have me talk to him? Because maybe he'll respond to me a little better. If you have a brother who is mild in, you know, who mild in temper, and he's seen as the fun, you know, the fun uncle, or the uncle that takes the pressure off, or the aunt that takes the pressure off everybody. She's the voice of reason, or he's the voice of reason, and she'll listen to them. Let them talk to them. You know, let them work with them, and you work with them. Have a program set to slowly reduce the violence, reduce it slowly, slowly, and slowly by reducing the anger, by doing the dua, by that young man doing the prayer, by and you working with them and them feeling that you care. Because if they feel that you care, they will respond, okay? But if they feel that they have to rebel against you all the time, okay, then that means that they don't really believe that you care. They haven't bought into what you're trying to sell them yet.
Now, we've covered a great issue here, which is control of giving too much control to a certain sibling that may lead to verbal or physical abuse. Now I want to transition over here a little bit and talk about an issue which lives in every home, and that issue is privacy. How much privacy should a parents give to their siblings? When is it too much and when is it not enough?
Well, first of all, we have to understand that our brothers must understand, and our parents first and foremost. Starting at a very young age, even giving your kids showers together is not looked upon favorably, okay, if they're of the opposite sex, or even if they're of the same gender, okay? This is not looked upon, this is considered makruh, okay? So try to stay away from that, so that you don't get them used to seeing each other, you know, naked. When you take them, for example, to the bathroom, make sure that you explain to them that son, daughter, you know, this is your private area. This is for you. Nobody else can come into this zone. Teach them early on also things about, you know, their own gender, you know, their own gender rights, you know, who has the right to see them and who doesn't have the right to see them. You have to explain from a young age. You have to infuse that from a young age. Do that with your daughter. Do that with your son, okay? What if your son opens up the door on your daughter and she's in the bathroom, okay? Make sure that you reprimand him and take him aside and say, no, son, even from a very young age, when a lot of people tell you that they don't understand what you're telling them, they do. They do. Okay, and you know, you have a little daughter. Yeah, yeah. When you tell her something, she's looking at you, you know, and she's mindful.
Yeah, they're okay? Amazing. They're amazing.
Yeah, and they pick up from a very young age. Keep infusing that in them. You know, I'm reminded by this hadith, and it's in Bab al-Aql in Al-Kafi. And in that hadith, subhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes his creation of intellect. He says, he makes intellect speak. He says in the hadith, he says, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala istantaq al-aql. He made it speak, okay? So he says to aql, go forward. Aql, intellect goes forward. He says, come back. Aql comes back. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala swears, and says, I swear that I have not created anything that is dearer to me than you, okay? That is more dear to me than you, okay? For it is through you that I order, that I command, and it is through you that I reprimand or that I prevent. And it is through you that I reward, and it is through you that I punish, okay? And then there's another hadith that describes when the archangel Gabriel, alayhi salam, was brought down onto Nabi Adam, and he said to him, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given me, ordered me to have you choose one of three things. Okay? So he said, okay, what are these three things? So Archangel Gabriel goes on and says to him, he says, intellect, shyness, and religion. You are to choose one. So Adam, alayhi salam, selects intellect. So Archangel Gabriel tells shyness, in Arabic haya, and religion, in Arabic is deen, to go back, to return from where they came. So both haya and deen, religion and shyness, say to Archangel Gabriel, no, we were ordered by Allah to stay with aql, with intellect, wherever it goes. So that tells you how important that shyness actually is. Okay? Now, we have to really foster that issue of shyness. Because a person that doesn't have shyness can do anything. Absolutely anything.
So no limits, almost.
No limits, okay? You'll see, for example, I know I was at a majlis once. I was, you know, at a gathering. And this brother, his son comes up to him, young son, maybe it could be about 5-6 years old. He whispers in his ear, he says to him, yeah, no problem. And he gets up to take him to the bathroom. Problem is, what does he do? He takes off his pants in front of everybody in the majlis. Like it's nothing. Like it's normal. Okay? And I'm thinking, well, if he's doing this in front of all of us, how are things at home? And he has at least 2-3 daughters. Okay? So we have to be mindful of this. Now, this is happening with his son. Inshallah, this isn't happening with his daughter too. Okay? Now, we have to be mindful. So we said, first of all, from a very young age, this whole showering together thing, okay, X that, cut that up, okay? It's makruh. Next thing, the whole issue of going to the bathroom. Teach them ahkam al-khala. Teach them, you know, mustahabbat al-khala, the things that are recommended when they go to the bathroom. Teach them that this is their private place. Teach them about their private parts and how important it is to hafz al-furuj. أن يحفظنا فروجهن, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says. Teach them that from an early age. Teach them what things are considered awra, what things are private parts that they're not supposed to expose to the public, that is haram for them to do that. Teach them things about mahram and non-mahram from a very young age. Teach them. Don't enforce mahram and non-mahram, you know, and make it something that there's ikrah in, that you're forcing them to do. Teach them. Just teach them. And keep teaching them. And then you'll see the fruits of your labor. Okay? Now, the child gets older. They're in their teenage years. There's another issue of privacy here, where it's not just an issue of shyness. It's an issue of personal space. Okay? As a parent, how much personal space should I really be giving my child? Okay? Well, yes, I trust my child. And you know, it's amazing. So you hear so many parents say, we trust our children. Blindly. No. Hang on a second. Okay? We just said, man, amin al-uquba, asa al-adab. The person who knows that they're not going to get punished, you know, they'll definitely have bad manners. Don't trust them blindly. Let them know that you're watching. You know, and more importantly, let them know that Allah is watching. Okay? So, instilling that in them will help you deal and manage their privacy. Now, a brother goes through his sister's stuff. That's unacceptable. He should not be going through her drawers. Okay, you're the only one that should be going through your daughter's drawers. Okay, you and her mother, and preferably her mother, and check with her mother and tell her, you know, what's going on with my daughter. If you don't communicate well with your daughter, but make sure that you do. Okay, and make sure you communicate with your son and don't have your daughter go in as though, you know. First thing, how many youth, okay, knock the doors when they walk through their sister's room. Even if the door is open, knock the door. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala orders us to do this. In the days of pre-Islamic times, this was a problem. People didn't have doors. People just walked through, you know. This is a problem. Islam came and asked people and commanded them to do istidhan, to ask permission, seek permission before you do anything. Okay, so we have to seek permission. They have to learn to seek permission, okay. And they have to learn to respect each other's privacy. They have to learn, and that comes from respecting each other. If you start from a young age, then you won't have a problem later on. Later on, it'll be harder to teach them. Later on, it'll be a matter of, the saying says, leave them for seven, teach them for seven, or discipline them for seven, and then befriend them for seven. Well, if you're in that latter, you know, the last 7 years where you're befriending them, now it's a lot. It's much tougher for you because they have habits, and now what you have to do is you have to cunningly, you know, work with them and befriend them and try to show them those habits are wrong and teach them better. And if they're 18 and you're sending them overseas, okay, to their brother or their sister, you know, who were raised differently than they were, and you didn't give them what you gave, the amount of time you gave their older siblings, then, you know, expect a recipe for disaster because those two siblings won't get together, you know. But, of course, we're not talking about the older siblings. We're talking about the younger generation, you know. But at the same time, realize that it can get to that point, okay, if you don't nip it early on.
So, obviously, that last stage you're talking about from 14 to 21, it comes really hard to change somebody's attitude and the way they live their life. Brother Aus, you mentioned a great point, was instilling the manners about into your kids very early. You mentioned about teaching, not enforcing. I want to touch on, just give you a little story about my daughter, and you mentioned something. We had one person come into our house, and he had just a small little slit in his shirt here. It wasn't really, you couldn't see anything. But she points at him and she says, "Aib," you know, "Aib, you shouldn't be doing this."
And "Aib" means shame.
Yeah, shame. Mm-hmm. It's shameful. You shouldn't be doing this. And it's amazing how you empower that my little girl, you know, how you give her that power and she uses it by just, you mentioned, teaching. Brother Aus, it was great information. Thank you again for being here, for giving us your time and sharing this, you know, wonderful, wonderful information and insight. Brothers and sisters, please, please keep sending your emails, comments, concerns. If you even feel like you have any requests for any shows, future shows, please send that in as well. Till next time, my name is Wissam Bazzi. Wassalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Ilahi. أسأله كشف